blue. Never heard before.
Somebody help me.
Send down your glory, Lord. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Yes. Let your power fall like never before. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Glory. Glory, 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 glory. Thank you, Lord. Like never before. Fall in this place. I never heard. Yes, Lord, hallelujah. Yes, Lord, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Yes, praising, 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 praising.
This place.
Amen, amen, amen. Like never before. Praise God. How you doing? How you doing? How you doing? This is Pastor Miller, the Great I Am Faith Center. And you know what? It's just a blessing to be back in the house of the Lord. I want you all to know how much we miss fellowshipping with you. First Lady, she's not with me today. She had grandbaby duty. Yeah, she's at home with the grandbaby, but she sends her love. She sends her regards. Know that we're praying for you all, and we love you. I'll say that again, and we loves us some you. Amen. Praise God. I guess you say, ooh, Pastor Mel fired up today. Yes, he is. Jesus will do that for you. Ooh, my God. Thank you, Lord. Glory. Hallelujah. Before we get started, I'd like to, you know, thank all of you that have stepped up, that have sown into the ministry during this period of time. I want you to know that your support has been amazing. And we're so thankful to have partners and family like you that during a time like this, you still sow into the ministry to keep the ministry flowing. What a blessing it is. What an honor it is. And what a privilege I have to have partners like yourself. I truly thank you. I truly mean that from the depths of my heart. I truly, 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 truly thank you. You are a blessing. Glory to God. You are a blessing. What I'd like to do right now is to pray over the tithes and the offerings that have come in. Oh, let's see. I did have mine. Okay. I think I left it in my briefcase. Did I put it in my pocket? All right. I was put mine in. I do have it prepared here. It must be in my briefcase, or my backpack, rather, in my backpack. But I want to pray over everything that's come in. Father, I thank you and praise you for translating us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom that you have prepared for us. Thank you. That is a kingdom of mercy, a kingdom of joy, a kingdom of peace, and a kingdom of abundance. Father, we have brought our tithe to you. Lord Jesus, you are our Savior. It is the first fruits of what you have given us, Lord. And Father, we planted it in the kingdom, your kingdom, as a seed of blessing, expecting the rich blessings of heaven to be multiplied to us in return. We thank you, Lord, that you rebuke Satan for our sake. And we stand in agreement with your word that he shall not destroy our land. No, he shall not. He'll not destroy our blessings. And he'll not destroy our crops in the field. We are citizens. Glory to God. We are citizens of your kingdom, Father. We have the right and the privilege of a citizen of that kingdom. And we stand upon them. We stand upon what we believe in your word. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that heaven's unlimited resources are ours in Jesus' name. Glory to God. Glory to God in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. I just wanted to pray over everything that has come. We pray over it on a regular basis, but I just wanted to have, now that you're with us, to have you join in with me to pray over the giving that has been done. You know, and for those that may be giving today. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. You know, there's some things that I want to go over today. Okay? But the first thing I want to do, I want to pray. Because we're in a time that is really just devastation. We see, seems to see everywhere. But we want to pray. We pray for the sick and the infected. God, heal and help them. Sustain their bodies and spirits. Contain the spread of this infectious virus. We pray for our vulnerable population. Lord God, protect our elderly and those suffering from chronic disease. Provide for the poor, especially the uninsured. We pray for the young and strong. God, give them the necessary caution to keep them from unwittingly spreading this disease. Inspire them to help. We pray for our local, state, and federal governments. Lord God, help our elected officials that they allot the necessary resources for combating this pandemic. Help them to provide more tests. We pray for our scientific community, leading the charge to understand this disease and communicate its gravity. God, give them knowledge, wisdom, and persuasive voice. Yes. Yes, we pray for the media. Let them be committed to truth, providing up-to-date information that is true. God, help them to communicate with the appropriate seriousness without causing panic. We pray for the consumers of the media looking to be well-informed. God, help us find the most helpful local information to equip us to be good neighbors, keep us from anxiety and panic, and enable us to implement the recommended strategies, even at the cost of ourselves. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. We pray for those with mental health challenges who feel isolated, anxious, and helpless. Lord God, provide them with the necessary support. We pray for the homeless unable to practice the protocols of social distancing in the shelter system. Protect them from disease and provide isolation shelters in every city. Yes, Lord. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, during this time, we all need to know how much God cares for us. You know, we need to know that his love for us is beyond words. Right now, many people are faced with so many different things. As you know, we have where what we hear, we have people sending us, you know, inboxing us on Facebook, emailing us, you know, and I know that you probably receive many of these different types of things. But I want you to know that God cares about you. You know, fear is all around us, and that doesn't mean that it has to be a part of our life. Fear will come, but it's what we do when fear comes that matters. You know, many people right now are standing in the valley of confusion because we hear so many different things. You know, one person says it's a conspiracy. The next says that it was created by man. This one says it was by bats. Right now, what we need is a word of truth. We need to remind ourselves and be reminded that God loves us, that God cares for us. As I look through our building today, you know, no one here, you know. But what the devil intended for evil, God has turned it to good. Because even though we're not here in this present building, we are together right now. We are together. Every home God is turning to his own church, amen, where you should be praying and reading your word, teaching your children Bible scriptures, fellowshipping with them. You know, we have that time now, and we should utilize it correctly. The Bible teaches us to use the time wisely, you know. So let's use this time that we have now to, with these stay-at-home orders, you know, let's use this time wisely. Amen? Amen. Let's turn in your Bibles to Isaiah 43. That's Isaiah chapter 43, and we're going to be looking at verses, we're going to center in on verses 1 and 2 for today, and we'll get to the rest of them at a later date. I'll give you a moment to get there, and also I'd like for you, you know, if you have the opportunity to prepare your items for communion at the end of this service, we will do communion together. Amen. So get your items together, and let's, you know, this is what we do every Sunday in our church, because the Bible teaches us that as often as we do this, we put him in remembrance. So we do it every Sunday, and I would pray and hope that you would be doing it, you know, during the week, you know, maybe 2-3 times or more during the week. Amen. So get your items together, and we will do that together, you know, right here, live stream. Amen. Amen. Okay. Now, what we're doing, and let me turn this phone off real quick, get everything together. Just bear with me, Pastor, trying to put it together. All right. Our media man is not here. Yeah, I miss you, Cleon. I miss you. Praise God. Amen. All right. All right. Here we go. Okay. One thing I need to check real quick, make sure everybody's being able to hear is good. All right. Okay. All right. We're about to have some good time in this word. Okay. You're at Isaiah 43. We're going to start at verse 1. Amen. Amen. But now, thus says the Lord, who created you, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Woo, that's powerful here. See, we've gone through so much, but we got to encourage ourselves with what God is saying to us and speaking to us. You know, no matter what we go through, we still belong to him, and he will continue to protect us. Amen. Look, the first thing I want to talk about is it says, who created you? Who created you? What does that mean? To create means to first think about something. In order for you to create something, you have to think about it before you make it. So what he's saying here, you were a thought in God's mind before you even became a seed in your mama's womb. Okay? You were a thought in God's mind. All right? Because see, this particular word here used, create, it means something that only God can do. God took nothing and made it something. Just like he did where it says over in Genesis, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void. In other words, we see in that verse, the same word where it says created is the same word here, bara, all right? which means God created something from nothing. Amen. Right now, that's shouting grounds. It goes on to say, who formed you? All right? Who formed you? To form means to squeeze something. To squeeze something into shape. Okay? He said, who formed you? So that means that God himself formed you. So many times we don't like the way we look. We have this issue, that issue. But God says, I formed you. The reason he formed you was to please him. You know, you got to know that in God's eyes, you are beautiful. You are loved. Yes, you are. In God's eyes, you are beautiful. You are loved. Amen? Amen. Jeremiah 1:5 says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Now, God is talking to Jeremiah. He says, before I formed you. Before I formed you, before I squeezed you, molded you, before you were born, before you was in your mama's womb, he says, I sanctified you, I ordained you a prophet to the nations. What am I saying and what are we getting from this? God said before you was even in your mama's womb, God had already instilled the gifts and the talents that were going to be in you. And he was going to use those as he does today for his glory. Those gifts and talents that you have, you know, you are to use those for the kingdom because they were given to you. They were designed specifically for you. When I read this scripture, I think about Jeremiah 18. Turn over in your Bibles to Jeremiah 18. You know, because when it talked about, you know, the implication that it gave, I formed you. I formed you. Thus says the Lord who created you, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel. I formed you. I thought about the potter. Oh, glory to God. I thought about the potter. The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord saying, arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause you to hear my words. Then I went down to the potter's house, and there he was, making something on the wheel. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in his hands. In other words, in his hands it became runt. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. So he made it again into another vessel, as it seemed good to the potter to make. What is it saying? I mean, think about it. Before we knew the Lord, God had a purpose, as we've seen already, before we were born. But if you were like me, you came into this world, you left the things of God, you weren't doing the things of God, that's considered being mired, runt in the potter's hands. All right? But then when you came to God, when you called out to him, when you decided to change your life, to surrender your life to him, that's where this part of the scripture comes in. So he made it again, another vessel, as it seemed good to the potter to make. Praise God for what God has done in our lives. Amen. Praise God for what he has done in our lives. Only he could do. Amen. 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 The second part of that verse says, but now, thus says the Lord, who created you, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, fear not. Oh, my God. We see that so much. Fear not. Fear not. And why is he telling you not to fear? The next part of this sentence is answering that question. For I have redeemed you. What does it mean to be redeemed? It means to be purchased. To be purchased back. You know, many of us may have had to use a pawn shop at one time or another. I know I have. Praise God. I know I have. You know, and when you go there, you give something of value. And what they do, they give you something monetary. And then they give you this ticket. And that ticket that you're to bring back to redeem what has been hawked. To redeem what has been hawked. Okay? When Adam sinned, he hopped all mankind. And what it took to redeem us was the blood and the life of Christ Jesus. What it took to redeem us is the blood and the life of Christ Jesus. You know, so that's why God is saying, you don't have to fear because you belong to me. God is saying, you belong to me, and I'm going to protect my property. I'm going to protect what belongs to me. It's no different than what you feel about your property. You're going to protect what belongs to you. You will protect your kids. You will protect your furniture. You will protect your car. You will not let someone destroy something that belongs to you. Neither will God let anything destroy you. Amen? Isaiah 54, 5 and 8 says, and I hope you're getting these scriptures because, you know, you need to go back over these scriptures after we finish just to get them in your spirit so that they can become a part of you. Isaiah 54, 5 and 8 says, for your maker is your husband. Woo, that's good. For your maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is his name. And your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel. He is called the God of the earth, the whole earth. For the Lord has called you like a woman forsaken and grieved in spirit, like a youthful wife when you refuse, says the Lord. For a mere moment I have forsaken you, but with great mercies I will gather you. With a little wrath, I hid my face from you for a moment, but with everlasting kindness I have mercy on you. Look at this scripture. I mean, really look at it. Isaiah 54, 5 and 8. 5 through 8. For your maker is your husband. God says he's married to you. He's married. That's the type of relationship that he says he wants you to understand. As a husband provides for his wife, God says, I intend to provide for you. As a husband protects his wife, God says, I intend to protect you. For your maker is your husband. And then God wanted you to understand who was being spoken of here. He says, the Lord of hosts is his name. And your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Then it goes on in this particular verse, and it says, I have called you by name. You know, it says, I have called you by name. God says he knows your name. He wants you to understand that he knows you. You know, you probably sometimes people say, well, how can God know me with all the people in the world? Because God created every one of us. If Adam was able to name all the animals, okay, because we don't see where he went to school or anything prior to naming all of those animals. What makes you think God cannot know every person's name? Let me show you something. In Exodus chapter 3, starting in verse 3. Now see, there's a man, he's over in the desert, he's gotten away from everybody, and it goes kind of like this. Then Moses said, I will turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. Moses was out in the desert minding his own business, but he seen this burning bush, and he looked, and he says, man, it's not being consumed. It's not burning up. So he said, let me go and look and see what's going on. See what's happening with this bush. Okay? So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called him from the midst of the bush and said, look what he said, and said, Moses, called him by name. He said, Moses, Moses. And Moses responded and said, here I am. See, God knows our name. God called Abraham. When he told Abraham, he said over in Genesis 12, 1 through 3, he says, oh, get out of your country, from your family and from your father's house, to a land that I will show you. To a land I will show you. Thank you, Lord. To a land I will show you. Okay? I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. But notice, he contacted Abraham. He knew Abraham. You know, same with Sarah, same with Isaac. You can find this throughout Scripture. So what makes you think that you're not known by God? God knows your name. You are his child. You are his child. Genesis 8:18, starting at verse 9. Then they said to him, "Where's Sarah, your wife?" This is when the angels came to talk to Abraham. He said, "Where's Sarah, your wife?" So he said, "Here in the tent." And he said, "I will certainly return to you according to the time of life. And behold, Sarah, your wife, she'll have a son." Now notice, they asked, where was Sarah? God knows your name. God knows your name. John chapter 10 verse 14 reads, "I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep." Woo, he says, "I know my sheep and am known by my own." Jesus said, "I know you." We're going through a whole lot. We're not forgotten about. God hasn't overlooked you. He hasn't overlooked your home. No, we may be going through, but that's what we're doing, going through. Amen? Amen. And in that same passage of Scripture in Isaiah, because I want you to just read this coming week, Isaiah 43, 1, 2, and 3. Just read it over and over. He says, "I have called you by your name." Then he makes this profound statement. He says, "You are mine." Just let that sink in for a minute. You are mine. Glory to God. I'm his. Why am I his? Because he purchased me. See, a lot of times we think we belong to ourselves, but that's not so. God says you belong to me. See, I want you to understand, when you came into this world, every one of us had a mother that brought her into the world. We came in through a womb, okay? We came in through a womb. Well, God had already created us. God had already formed us before we even entered into that womb. Our mothers were just a channel. Our fathers were just an instrument that God chose to use to bring us into this world. Some people have good parents, some people have bad. But what I'm saying to you, we ought to all be thankful that God chose them to get us in. He got us in here. Why? Because he has a purpose for us. Our lives have meaning to him. We have meaning to him. God cares about us. Yes, yes, all we're hearing about now is coronavirus 19. But let's start talking about Jesus the Christ. Jesus the Christ. Jesus the Anointed One. Let's start talking about Jehovah Shalom. You understand me? God of our peace. Let's start talking about Jehovah Rapha, the Lord God that heals. Let's put more on God than we're putting on this corona. Yes, yes, yes. They're talking about how many people are affected, how many people are dying. But you know what? There are so many people that have recovered. There are so many people that have returned home. There are people that we know that were in the hospital, you know, on ventilators. But you know what? Today they're home. They're with their families. God raised them up. God brought them out. You know, so yes, people have lost loved ones, and we're praying for them. We want God's comfort for them. But understand, there are those that are being saved, those that are being delivered. You know, we belong to Him. We belong to Him. And as Paul said, to be absent from the body is to be what? Present with the Lord. Amen. Okay. He says, you are mine. Let's look at that. Deuteronomy 10:14 says, Indeed, heaven and the highest heavens belong to the Lord, your God, and the earth with all that is in it. It says right here, the heavens and the earth belong to God, and all that's in them belong to Him. And if we're in the earth, that means what? We belong to Him. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. It says also here in Psalms 89:11, the heavens are yours, and the earth also is yours, the world and all its fullness. You have founded it. The earth and all its fullness. Psalms 24:1 says, the earth is the Lord's and all its fullness, the world and those who dwell therein. 1 Corinthians 10:26, for the earth is the Lord's and all its fullness. So always remember that you belong to God, and everything that God has blessed you with, your children, your job, your home, your cars, your clothes, even the clothes on your back. He blessed you with these things. Amen. Oh my God. Let's look back at this scripture. But thus says the Lord who created you, O Jacob, and He who formed you, O Israel, fear not, fear not, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flames scorch you. For I am the Lord, your God, the Holy One of Israel. Wow. He says, when you walk. Notice what it says, when you walk. See, when you use the word when, that means that it's going to happen at some time or another. It says, when you walk through the fire. Let's go back up. When you pass through the waters. When you pass, verse 2, when you pass through the waters. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. Speaks one moment of waters and the next moment of rivers, showing that we will face different circumstances in life. Some will be heavier than others. Some will be at different levels than others. But He says, I will be with you. They will not overflow you. When you. We're faced with something now. But God says, I will be with you. It will not overflow you. Amen? He says, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. They shall not. Say that with me. They shall not overflow me. This situation shall not overtake me. This situation shall not overcome me. Say it to yourself. Say it loud. Say, I am more than a conquering. God has created me that way. My Father loves me. My Father cares for me. He is going to protect me. He is going to keep me. He is going to watch over me. He is going to watch over my family. He is going to watch over my possessions. He is my God. He is my Father. Say it like you mean it. Amen. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire. Notice what He said. When you walk through the fire. You understand? When things get hot. Woo, glory to God. When things get hot, it shall not overflow you. It shall not take you. It shall not burn you. You shall not be consumed by it. He says, when you walk through the fire. See, to say that when you walk through means that you have an exit point. You may be in there, but you in motion. You in motion. You in motion while you in there. You're headed out of there. Whatever you're going through today, I'm telling you right now, you're headed out. When you walk through the fire, when you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned. We know some people over in the Old Testament. Three Hebrew boys that was thrown in a fiery furnace. And they weren't burnt. And it says that their clothes didn't even smell like smoke. I'm trying to tell you now that what you've been through in life, what you've walked through, the fires you've had to endure, people will look at you and never know you've ever been through anything until you tell them. That's the God that we serve. Amen. That's the God that we serve. Oh, people, I'm just loving this. I'm just loving this. You see, when trouble comes, there's a scripture I like over in Psalms 34:19, where it says, many are the afflictions of the righteous. It says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them out of them all. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord, our Savior, our deliverer, delivers us out of them all. Not some, he says, delivers them out of them all. Maybe the deliverance that we receive may not be at the time that we want. Maybe we go through it and we feel we're in it too long. But God says, and he promised, he says, I will deliver you out of them all. Out of them all. He says, I will deliver you out of them all. That is a promise. That is a command. That is a statement that God has made on our behalf. Psalms 34:6 says, the poor man cries out, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. See, scripture over in the Old Testament says, Jeremiah 33:3 says, call unto me. That's an invitation. God says, call unto me, and I will answer thee. And not only will he answer thee, he said, I will show thee great and mighty things. This is our prayer time. We need to bump it up. We need to lift up our prayer time. We need to start praying in the spirit, praying with understanding, worshiping, lifting our hands to God, worshiping him, walking through our homes, praising and worshiping him. Oh, my God. And I want to close with this. I take this scripture, Isaiah 43:1-3, and I read it like this. And I'm going to do this first and share it with you, and then you can, you know, write it in your Bible. But now, thus says the Lord who created you, put your name there, and he who formed you, put your name there. Fear not, put your name there, for I have redeemed you. Put your name after redeemed you. For I have called you by name, you are mine. Now notice this. This is how I read it to myself. But now, thus says the Lord, who created you, Melvin, and he who formed you, Melvin. Fear not, Melvin, for I have redeemed you. Melvin, God has called you by your name. You belong to him. When you pass through the waters, he will be with you. And the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the fire scorch you, Melvin. See, I make that personal for me. You know, and what we should have learned from this is four different points. One, God created and formed us for himself and his purpose. God created and formed us for himself and his purpose. Two, God knows us by name. We have a personal relationship, each and every one of us, with God because he knows us by name. Three, God redeemed us. He owns us. We're his, and he will protect what belongs to him. Four, God protects us. I read those again for you. God created us and formed us for himself and his purpose. One. Two, God knows us by name. Three, God redeemed us and owns us. Four, God protect us. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Let us get ready for communion. Pray you have your elements there. Let me grab mine real quick. And okay. Amen. Thank you, Father God, for the word that has gone forth. Thank you, Father, for the hearts that it has been planted in. And Father, we thank you for being who you are, for loving us the way you do. Father, as we hold these elements in our hand, we remember what Jesus paid for us, what he gave up for us, his life and his blood. And Father, as we hold these elements, they represent the body and the blood of our Savior, Christ Jesus. So Father, we now take and partake of the bread which represents the body. Please partake. Father, we hold this cup in the air that represents the blood that was shed for us, the blood that redeemed us, the blood that sanctifies us, the blood that justifies us. Father, we now partake. And just as we, Father, have consumed these elements, and these elements and I are now one, Father God, we are one with you, and we are one with the Lord Jesus. We thank you. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, this is Pastor Mel. I love each and every one of you, and hopefully we'll be back together in the sanctuary soon. But until then, remember, God bless you. God loves you. God cares for you. God bless. Amen.
Tonight. Oh, Jesus.